Christian services were really full. They probably had good plans, enjoy the sunshine today. Probably won't happen next week, though, because next week, daylight savings time begins. This is a rough time. So everybody, next week, this service will be full, because everybody will come to that service. So just remember to spring forward, move your clocks ahead an hour, and just plan accordingly. Ash Wednesday service, just a beautiful service this past Wednesday. Our noon service, there were 65 that were present at the noon service, 101 in the 7 p.m. evening service. And I hope that all of you will join Vicar and me on this Lenten journey and join us this year as we focus on the seven statements of Jesus spoken from the cross. In fact, the banner from this past Wednesday is still there. Jesus' first statement from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And there will be a different banner this Wednesday for the second statement of Jesus from the cross. Today, you will be with me in paradise. So please join us at either noon or at 7 p.m. Caleb, I'd like to invite you to come up for an announcement. Caleb is going to be starting a new Bible class next week. I'm going to let him tell you a little bit about it. But I know Caleb's father personally. He's a pastor. We were missionaries for a time in Venezuela. He's in the military. He's a chaplain in the armed forces. And Caleb is known as what is called a PK. He's a preacher's kid. He's also a UNF student in microbiology, looking towards getting his PhD eventually, but he wants to have a bio class, so I'm going to let him tell you about it.
So the class will be mainly for middle school and high school students, although anyone is welcome to come. But what we'll be focusing on, the purpose of the study, is to try to follow what 1 Peter 3:15 tells us, which is to always be prepared to give a defense for the hope that we have. So what we'll be doing is focusing on Genesis from an apologetics perspective, looking at the creation and a little bit more of the science behind that. And we'll also be going over basic common Christian questions and how to answer them. It'll be a conversation class. We'll be focusing a lot on the students' questions, just to enable the students here to be able to give that defense, to be able to give a reason for the hope that we have in a time when the faith is so much under attack. So if you'd like to ask me any questions or discuss it, I will be here after the service. Thank you
very much, Caleb. So he'll be here after the worship today to meet with anyone that's interested, particularly the youth. Any of the students of the congregation, so that they can participate in Caleb's class that's going to start next week. My last announcement is, thank you very much, Caleb. LWML has a breakfast this coming Saturday. The breakfast is going to be held from 9 to 10:30 across the street in the cottage. All the women of the congregation are invited, and this week for the breakfast, everyone is asked to bring a breakfast item to share.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Soon to be afternoon. So for interested parties, I kind of embarrassed my wife a little bit last service with this. She's been pushing me to make sure everyone knows that we are now having a baby boy. And so right now we are in the name process because I was certain we were going to have a girl. I really was. And we had girl names in our head, especially one in particular. So now we've got to figure out boy names. So pray for us. Please pray for our unborn child that they'll be safe and healthy and continue to grow and develop in a good way. Also, today begins the first week of a four-week series entitled Safe to Serve. You will see that slide soon enough on the projectors up there. This series will progress starting today with a focus on making the church into a safe place, into areas of service. And really the goal here is entirely in the name. We want to be that congregation that allows people to come in, whoever they may be, and feel safe and welcomed and able to grow and mature and eventually to serve within the life of the congregation and also to give their God-given gifts outwards towards their neighbors. So be looking forward to the next following 3 weeks. I'll be preaching the following 3 Sundays as well. And I thank you for the opportunity to preach this important message to you.
Thank you, Vicar. Last service, somebody actually raised their hand and said they had a name suggestion. So we're not going to do that today, but I'm sure, feel free to share whatever names come to mind here at the door. God's blessings upon your worship today. Let's stand and share the peace of the Lord with one another. So may it be. Amen. Having heard those wonderful words of gospel and forgiveness, we stand and sing.
It will produce thorns and thistles for you,
and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return. Adam named his wife Eve, because she would become the mother of all the living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife, and clothed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is recorded in St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, the second chapter. When Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he was clearly in the wrong. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles, because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, "You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by observing the law, no one will be justified." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us now join together and confess our holy Christian faith to one another and with Christians throughout the world in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Thank you.
Lord, today speak your word faithfully and according to your truth. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As I mentioned today at the, well, really towards the end of the announcements, today begins the first in a series of four. I will be preaching the following three Sundays as well. A series entitled, as you can see on the screen now, Safe to Serve. And the name is also the goal of the series. We are hoping to encourage this place, this congregation, to become ever more a place that welcomes in the sinner, that welcomes the outsider, that takes people in from outside and in our communities and brings them into the life of the church, integrates them, and allows them to serve both us here and again out towards their neighbors. And so this first day we'll be focusing in many ways on that first word or concept of safety. Now, I want to tell you a story about when I was growing up. I knew a family from church who had a lot of kids, and I admit to you, my idea of a lot of kids is somewhere between 6 and 8. If that's not a lot to you, or you came from a larger family, Lord have mercy on you. I wish you well. I come from a family of 3 brothers, one of which came 13 years after me, so it was very different. But it was a pretty big family, and we spent a lot of time together, birthdays, activities, church things. We even played roller hockey for several years with 2 of the boys. Now, one of the youngest boys, who was about the same age as me, was a little different from the rest of the family. First of all, he didn't have the same skin color as the other children. He had some developmental problems and a little bit of trouble with school. What I didn't know for quite some time as a child was the circumstances surrounding his birth. His biological mother had been a crack addict who couldn't take care of him. He himself was born addicted to crack. He cried almost nonstop for the first couple years of his life. And although his parents were very patient and kind to him, there were many times where he and his siblings just struggled to get along. He was different from them. He had some baggage, so to speak. You could say he was adopted. Now, I want to refer you today to the epistle lesson that we read earlier in the book of Galatians. And I know in this lesson there's a very important truth, the way we normally read it, that discusses this idea that our salvation, our justification, is centered in faith in Jesus Christ. There is no need for the works of the law. They are powerless to do what faith in Christ does every time, which is save. But there is another context behind the scenes here of Paul relating this incident with Peter that is important for our study today. You see, the early church starts out very much a Jewish institution to begin with. The temple for 40 years, roughly after Jesus' death, still stands. Sacrifices are being offered, the festivals are continuing, the people are still eating the same food. Their culture didn't change overnight. But something miraculously did change overnight, and that was the inclusion of the Gentiles. Suddenly, this salvation that had accorded so well and so neatly with everything in the Old Testament was flipped on its head when literally anyone could come in. And in that coming together, that unification, there was some real difficulties because these Gentiles were nothing like the Jews. They didn't care about the same mores of clean and unclean. They weren't concerned about the foods. They didn't care at all about their worship practices. They looked different. They had no connection to Abraham or Isaac or Jacob. They were truly separate entities now being merged into one.
And there's something very stunning, I think, in this text here about Peter's hypocrisy, as Paul puts it. You see, if you remember, even though Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles, he did not start Gentile ministry. If you remember, it was Peter traveling to the house of Cornelius and preaching the good news of Jesus Christ and seeing that the Spirit of God had descended upon all of these Gentiles exactly the same way as at Pentecost. They were speaking in new tongues and experiencing the new life of the Spirit in exactly the same way. There was no distinction. And so when Peter had initially come back to the churches, it was this mind-blowingly good news. Can you believe that God's Spirit has come to rest upon the Gentiles? And now a time comes when this group who has taken the truth of the gospel and taken the law of Moses and tried to make some kind of amalgamation of the two is demanding that people get circumcised. They're demanding that you follow Jewish customs. You got to eat like we eat, dress as we dress, follow our rules if you want to be saved. And so, when we see Peter in this story, he's actually conceding, giving in to the demands of this group that they call the circumcision party. So what does he do? He ends the table fellowship and friendship with the Gentiles. Not eating with someone wasn't just a slight in some minor way, like, oh, I'm not going to be around you because you're unclean. It's really a way of saying, we're not friends. We're not connected. We don't have fellowship. And it was terribly ironic because he himself was living a lot like a Gentile and nothing at all really like a Jew. The only distinction between Peter and the other Gentiles was that he was born differently.